basically. But there's something great about Kaliyuga actually, which nobody knows.
Tell me, because I haven't seen anything great. I want you to give me good feeling of Kaliyuga.
You will not see this anywhere. You will only see this in Srimad Bhagavatam. So what is Srimad Bhagavatam basically? All the Vedic scriptures, most of them have been written by the great sage Vyasdev. Vyasdev, his guru is Narad Muni, whose guru is Lord Brahma, who is the creator of this material universe. Okay, and Lord Brahma got this knowledge from Lord Vishnu. That's what is mentioned in Bhagavatam. Tene Brahma Hrida Adi Kavaye Muhyanti Yat Surayaha. That Lord Vishnu gave this knowledge to the Adi Kavi, Lord Brahma. Okay, so Brahma gave this to his son Narad Muni, and his disciple was Vyas, Maharishi Vyas, Vyasdev, and he is an empowered incarnation of Lord Vishnu, which means he's a Shaktyavesh avatar, which means he's a normal living entity. He's not God himself, but he's empowered specifically by Lord Vishnu. So he can also behave as if he's God in full. Okay, he's an empowered representative. So Vyasdev wrote all the scriptures, you know, all the Vedas, Puranas, you know, everything he wrote. And then finally, what happens? He was dissatisfied. After writing all the scriptures, can you believe it? He did not write books on, you know, Harry Potter or, you know, cricket or, you know, football. No, he was writing divine books. After writing all this, he was unhappy. He was sitting in the banks of the river Saraswati and he was morose. And then I was like, my God, Vyasdev is morose, you know. What is our hope?
Yes, yes.
And then his guru Narad Muni came. And Narad Muni understood why he was morose. But Narad Muni, you know, he was a bit in a fun, he was, you know, a bit on a jolly mood that day. Mm-hmm. And he sarcastically addresses Vyasdev, sarcastically. He says to Vyasdev, you know, oh, great sage, how's life? In fact, then Vyasdev was so embarrassed. He was like, I know you know I'm unhappy, still you are saying like that, you know. And then he confesses to his guru. He says, I don't know what is the problem. I have written so much, I have done so much, you know, still I'm miserable. Something is missing inside, you know. But I don't know what that is, you know. And when a disciple is confused or he's morose or he doesn't know why he's morose, he just goes to the guru and asks, you know, my dear Guru Maharaj, what is the problem? Only you can tell it. And then Narad Muni explains to him that, my dear disciple, you have written all the books. Very good job. But you did one blunder. And until you rectify that mistake, you will be miserable for the rest of your life. You will be like this only. You will sit and cry. And what was that mistake? That mistake was, he did not write any book which exclusively talks of core spirituality. Which means, I only want God, nobody else. Like most of the times, if you see in India, like the Vedas, you know, the Upanishads and all this, you know, they will have so many things. If you do this yagya, if you do this homa, if you take, you know, gemstones, you know, hands, you will get money, you will get a beautiful wife or, you know, nice husband or something like that. These are like using resources of God to fulfill your Rahu desires, right?
All right. Yes. Yes.
Yes. You are not interested in God. The only difference is you are a bit religious, you know. You are not like that atheist who says, you know, oh, I will do things myself, you know, I will just do what I want. You are a bit religious. You say, okay, you know, I will go to God and ask him, you know, if wearing this stone or, you know, doing this puja or mantra, yantra, mudra, tantra, all these things, you know.
Yeah.
And give me something, you know. I will go to Lord Shiva. They say, if you want a good wife, you should go to Lord Shiva. And if you want a good husband, you should go to Goddess Parvati. Now, when a man goes to Lord Shiva for a good wife, he's not interested in Shiva. He's interested in... Yeah. You understand?
Yeah.
You got it.
Exactly. Very good. Very good fine point. Yeah.
Yeah, then Vyasdev told, this is your blunder. Narad Muni told Vyasdev, this is the blunder you have done.
Oh, very now, good, very good.
All these books, you know, where there are fancy stuff, you know, if you do 100 Ashwamedh Yajnas, you become Indra, the king of the heavens. Okay? If you do this, you become that. If you do 1,000, you become Brahma. You know, these are all the fancy stuff which is there. You know, if you chant this mantra, you will get money, you will get, you know, in India, people are obsessed in this occasions like Akshaya Tritiya and Diwali, Dhanteras, you know. They will worship Lakshmi. Om Jai Lakshmi Mata. They will say. So they are saying Goddess Lakshmi was so great, but they are least interested in her. You know, they are only interested in her resources. You know?
Oh.
They just want money. So for that, maybe they may go to a bank or to Goddess Lakshmi. You know, that's the difference. You know, you go to an investment banker, you know, how can I double my money in 5 years, 10 years, 2 years? Or you go to Goddess Lakshmi. But irrespective of that, you are not desiring to go close to God as a person.
Oh, yeah.
Till the time, the problem with this approach is, till the time God is fulfilling your desires, you are very nice and religious. The moment God stops, you are an atheist. That is why many people I talk to in trains or buses, you know, atheist. This I ask them, why were you atheist from your birth, from day one when you were in the mother's womb? You used to shout, you know, God doesn't exist, or you became atheist after coming out? They said, no, first 10 years of my life I was religious, you know, Hindu, Christian, Muslim, whatever. After 11, 12 years or after 15 years I became an atheist. Why? Because whatever I used to pray, God never gave me, so it doesn't exist. So God is like my servant, you know. Till the time he is obeying my orders,
okay,
I will talk about him, you know, maybe once in a day. But the day he stops giving me, I throw him out of my life. He doesn't exist for me. So then Vyasdev wrote another book. It is known as Srimad Bhagavatam, where he exclusively talks only of spirituality, and he only talks of Lord Vishnu. And
can
how
we
to
make a list under this video of these books, because this series of books, because it's very interesting.
Yeah, thank only you. One book is required. That's sufficient.
Wonderful. Mm-hmm.
And in the Srimad Bhagavatam, there's one shloka in the beginning, you know, first canto, first chapter, first verse, you know, dharma projitavatro kaitavatro paramo nirmatsaranam satam. That Srimad Bhagavatam kicks away, you know, it's a very strong word, kicks away all other substandard religious principles and ideologies. This doesn't mean it kicks away Christianity or Islam or anything like that. Anything in any religion, inside Hinduism or in Christianity or Islam, wherever, anything which gives you less of God.
There is only one creator. Yeah.
Yes. Bhagavatam says, you are in the wrong place. If that is you, get out. You will not be happy reading this. All right? Because here you will only get knowledge about God. You won't get petty things like, okay, do this mantra, you'll get 100 euros. You know, these kind of petty things, these are not allowed here. Because it is, Bhagavatam is the Nigama Kalpato, you know, that shloka is there, no? Shuka Mukha Amrita Davya Samyatam. It is like the ripened fruit. You know, it's like in India, it's mango season now.
Yeah.
So maybe the season has gone, you know. So, it's like, you know, imagine a ripe mango, how it is, you know, so tasty. Ripened fruit of the Vedic literatures. You know, it's like, imagine the Vedic literatures, they are like a tree. You know, there are Vedas. Vedas is somewhere, Upanishads, Rama and Mahabharata, all this is there. And imagine the ripened fruit is like there, you know. And how amazing it will be, you know, the taste.
Yes, yes.
So Vyasdev wrote that, and that is the book which talks you exclusively about spirituality. So the Bhagavad Gita, which is a part of the Mahabharata, Bhagavad Gita is the book which tells you who you are, who and who God is, and how to go to Him.
Oh, that's wonderful. Mm-hmm.
Okay, but it's like a very long journey, you know. It's like, suppose suddenly tomorrow God comes and tells you, okay, you are here, I am here, do this and you can come to me. You will be like, fine, that's great, I understand, but how do I do it? You know, can you explain?
Can we advise people now when these eclipses are taking place and they're one after another, piling up, you know, the energy after energy?
Yeah, they're piling off the recycle bin.
That's the thing, yes. So how can we, if this is on a key position in their horoscopes, like on ascendant or mid-heaven or key, or with the moon or with the sun, or this is how, and if they experience dense energies, how can they reverse the energies to, like, because you gave very good explanation on what Rahu is, what Ketu is, what kind of measures they can take during eclipse and after eclipse so that they really do not suffer from the influences, because they're never easy, the eclipses. They like, they come like they open the portals from the sky and justice comes, you know, or injustice, we don't know.
Yeah, so there are many things which people can do. For example, see, the best way to not let Rahu impact us, because see, ultimately what is eclipse? It's nothing fancy, just Rahu basically.
No.
So if you want to treat eclipses, just treat Rahu. And how do you treat a planet? You know, it's very simple. If it is a malefic, then stay away from the traits which that planet represents. And if it is a benefic, stay with those traits which that planet represents. All right. So what is Rahu basically? Rahu represents darkness. So the first thing that people should do is sleep early.
Sleep early. Wonderful.
Mm-hmm. Yes. And get up early and do spiritual practices in the morning. You know, that's the very interesting thing I have seen. People will do so many big, big things. You know, these simple things they will miss.
Fully agree.
If you do not let Rahu enter your consciousness, how will he impact you? He cannot. Yes. And I was telling you that time, you know, about Kaliyuga, there is one great thing. In fact, this is the perfect time to say about that.
Yes, yes.
In that Srimad Bhagavatam, in the last, you know, towards the end, you know, there's a shloka, very beautiful shloka, where Sukhdev Goswami is the son of Vyasdev, who is speaking the Srimad Bhagavatam again, you know, after hearing it from his father.
Mm-hmm.
He says to Parikshit Maharaj, he's one of the kings, he says, Kaler dosha nidhe rajan, means he says, my dear king, Kaliyuga is an ocean of faults. All right. Then he says, asti hi ekan mahat gunan. He said, but there is one great quality, mahat gunan. Then he says, kirtana deva krishnasya mukta sangha param vrajet. He says, one who chants the names of Lord Krishna, mukta sangha param vrajet, he will be delivered of all problems. So this is the one short remedy, and using astrology you can also prove this.
How? Definitely.
How? Because there is a concept of dig chakra, you know. I will explain that some other time. Dig chakra is a concept where there are planets in opposition. Opposition doesn't mean they are enemies, but the negative influence of a particular planet is countered by the planet which is on the other side. Okay, so if you see in that Dik Chakra, exactly opposite of Rahu is Mercury. And Mercury is basically Lord Vishnu. Okay, mm-hmm. So because he was the one who severed the head of Rahu, right?
So they're not friends for sure.
Yeah, so that is why when we do spiritual practices related to Lord Vishnu, then Rahu can easily be checked. And at a practical level, you have to take care of the 11th house. 11th house means all the people who you listen to, you know, your ears.
Can we say that it's very important to see in the horoscope the relationship between Mercury and Rahu, to see how are they related, so that you can really derive how Rahu will influence you, right? The two enemies, basically.
Yes. Yeah, and it's very interesting, you know, like astrologically these two are friends, because Mercury also represents the finance sector, but when you talk at a higher level,
mm-hmm.
then Mercury can control all the negativity which is there of Rahu, because Rahu is what? Illusion, right? And Mercury is the significator of intelligence. So in Gita, there's the shloka, you know, krodhat bhavati sammodha, sammodhat smriti vibhrama, smriti bhamshat buddhi nasho, buddhi nashat pranashati, which in short means when intelligence is lost, then you become a fool. You fall prey to illusion. So if you read the holy texts, you read books like scriptures like the Srimad Bhagavatam, you read scriptures like the Rama and the Mahabharat, then your intelligence is very sharp. Then Rahu cannot do anything. Maybe he's there right beside you. He's whispering in your ears, you know, hey, there's this party tonight. Like I'm working in a company now known as Media Mart. And in Germany now they have this, you know, summer parties, you know. So 12th of July, which is this Friday, you know, they have started sending mails, you know, oh, we have this summer party, you know. And then I was like, okay, what's going on? Oh, it starts at 9. And I'm like, that's the time the sun is setting, you know. Dharma is, the sunset means Dharma is dead. Sun has gone. Mm-hmm, that is the time Rahu has come up.
The night sun.
Yes, that is the time sunset. Sun in the seventh house, Saturn gets exalted, Libra. That's why Saturn gets exalted in Libra, you see. Because when Sun is down, your propensity to commit sin is the highest. And that is where Saturn can hit you right, left. And that's what Rahu is basically. So when their party is starting, when Rahu is waking up, you see?
How? And they don't understand that this is actually driven from the sky astrologically.
Yeah, they're ruining their entire lives by doing these parties. And, you know, they will keep partying till 4 a.m. And then I'm like, yes. And at 4 a.m., what to do? The sun is up, so I go to sleep, right? I'm tired after the party. My God, Dharma is getting up that time. That is the time you should get up and do spiritual practice. And that is the time you are going to sleep. My God, that's epic.
Oh, very good. You gave a good advice. So
if we at a practical level, if we make sure that we can sleep early as possible, preferably before 10, you know, because as per science also they say, you know, there is a wave which goes on in your body. If after 10 or 10:30 you miss it, then it takes a long time to get the next wave. You know, there's some videos which I have seen. But anyways, that's secondary. The thing is, if you can sleep early and if you can get up early and you can do mantras in the morning and you can hear lectures of spiritual gurus, and in the weekends, if you can go and meet spiritual people in the spiritual community, that's instead wonderful. Of just for a wine party or, you know, something like
this
that.
This way you're pleasing a little bit more Ketu, right? Who is less harmful, because they always go together, Rahu and Ketu. So when you follow beautiful spiritual practices, welcome the sun and do according to your belief system, all these, then you're pleasing Ketu, who is then also not harmful for you, to you, right?
Yeah, because see, Ketu is a very beautiful planet. Ketu ultimately tells you that, Ketu just tells you one thing. Ketu tells you, you don't own anything in this world. Because Ketu is the significator of 8th house, death. Death means what? What is death?
Detachment.
Death means whatever you did in the last 80 years is over. Bye-bye. See you next time. Yes? It's like such a useless cycle, you see. You get up, you work, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, then 10th standard, 11th, 12th, engineering, then master's, then you get married, then kids, then home, then car, then promotion, and then you...
Then 8th house. Then 8th house. Yeah,
such a useless endeavor. So an intelligent person will ask this question, how can I put a full stop to this stupid game? Because one of my gurus used to say, you know, that Rahu is like playing a game, but there are two characteristics of that game. The first characteristic is you will never win the game. And the second is you can never stop.
Yeah. Yes.
It's like playing a game which you will never win. And once you start, you can't stop. I mean, a normal person will never play that game, right? Only a fool will play a game which he can never win and which he cannot stop. So anybody who is intelligent doesn't mean, you know, scientifically or, you know, in computing sector.
No, it's naturally intelligent, yeah.
Yeah, one who knows the word of the rishis or, you know, Bible or Quran or whichever religious or scriptural tradition you follow, then you will understand what Rahu is. It's very simple, actually. So people make Rahu very complicated. Oh, Rahu is this, Rahu is that. No, Rahu is very simple, actually. Rahu is that which tells you, you know, you can be happy without God. You don't need God. Just throw him out. Kick him out. Just ditch him, you know. Just do everything else. That is why when you give holy books like the Bhagavad Gita to people, you know, what do they say? Ah, I want to read it, you know, but the problem is I don't have time. Yes, you have time to watch cricket, you have time to watch football, you have time to watch the news, you have time to watch Game of Thrones, you have time to read Harry Potter, but you don't have time to read the Gita. You don't have time or you don't want to make time? That's the question, right? Because saying that I don't have time for something is essentially like saying I don't want to do it.
Very true. Very true.
So you always make time. You always make time for the things which you want to do, right?
Priorities, very true. So, yeah. So we can summarize with this that the holy scripts have the answer, the mythology of the different philosophical systems, of course, whatever people follow, of course, that are the answers. And we, yes. And actually,
Last thing I would say is all this is for us, ourselves, and most importantly, what happens is we may hear these lectures, we may start off with something wonderful, that's fine. But this Kaliyuga does not let us continue that for very long.
Mm.
Yes, it will pull us down. So how does he pull you down? Aquarius, 11th house, that's where Rahu sits, that is his kingdom. So all activities of Rahu starts and it ends in the 11th house. If you want to check Rahu, check the 11th house. Any problem of Rahu. In fact, in the scriptures, it is said, you know, there is only one reason why there are bad activities in this world. Anything bad. That is bad association. When you associate with a Vishayi. Vishayi means one who is talking to you about materialistic pleasures.
Very good.
That is why it is said, more, you know, when you are going forward on a spiritual path, if you get obsessed with the opposite sex, it's very detrimental. But it is said that more dangerous than getting obsessed with the opposite sex is staying with a person who is obsessed with the opposite sex. Because then they put in your ears, you know, oh, look, that girl is so nice. You know, we had such an amazing, you know, experience yesterday night. You should also try it out, you know.
Oh, very nice. This very
So he's the 11th house, you see. 11th house, your social community. So if you want to check Rahu, one thing is to start doing things yourself, that's fine. But that cannot give you long-term continuity. Because the moment you step out of your room, you have the 11th house. You see your friends, your colleagues, they will rip you apart. They will pull you down. They will always discourage you. They will throw you out of their society. Yes, so then you have to replace it with the community of spiritual people.
So everything is in our hands.
Yes, wherever you are, try to maintain communications with the nearby spiritual community in the weekdays or once in a month. That's mandatory. How much ever you are earning, how much ever you are saving, that's not important. Important is, are you able to invest time going to a spiritual community, you know? Or if you can't, then once in 3 months at least, that is like bare minimum, you know.
Yes. Thank you so much. Yes.
You do that, then you can continue your spiritual practices alone in the home. Okay. Because ultimately you have to drive your own car. Your guru will not do it for you.
Certainly. Thank you for your wisdom. Certainly. This was wonderful, and I'm sure it will be very useful for the people that are watching us. Thank you so much for your ancient wisdom, and I hope we talk again on my channel.
Yeah, the next time you will talk on my channel on Babylonian history.
With greatest pleasure. This was really great. I love the ancient Vedic knowledge. It was wonderful. Thank you so much. And people are welcome to comment, to send us questions. This will be wonderful. And your contacts of the esoteric astrology will certainly be also under this video. Thank you so much, yes, Babaji. Thank you so much.
Thank you for inviting me also. Okay, see you again.
Pleasure. Thank you.